Hi, I'm Agent Jay-Z, and welcome to Jet City. This, believe it or not, is the front end of an Orenda Iroquois, the real thing. We're building it up slowly and carefully to put on display, and the dream is one day to run it. Now, right next to it, you can see that other black thing. That's an Orenda Type 14, the older, smaller brother to the Iroquois. And way over there, that's the compressor rotor out of an Orenda 14. But we're not here today to talk about the Orenda Iroquois or the Orenda 14. We work on an engine here that I've never really talked about. We do quite a bit of work on it, and there's many of them out there producing power for oil and gas. There's also all the US Navy destroyers and cruisers use it to generate electricity. And it's also, as an aircraft engine, the unit that powers the C-130 Hercules, the P-3 Orion, the Convair 580, the Super Guppy, and let's see what else, the E-2 Hawkeye. Now, we haven't featured this engine before, for reasons unbeknownst to me, but we're going to today because we have a unique opportunity. Because one of the guys in our shop, Big Al Von Hollen, has spent the last week making a cutaway of this engine for a technical school in Grand Prairie, Alberta. And I'm speaking, of course, of the Allison, now Rolls-Royce, T56 turboprop. This is the gas generator, and we're going to take a quick tour of the cutaway of the Type 501, which is the industrial name for the T56 turboprop. Okay, in the T56, there's a large shaft coming right out here of the cold end. And it comes out several feet, and there's a large reduction gearbox which reduces the speed of the gas generator, which is 13,800, I'm going to call it 14,000 RPM, down to around 2,500 RPM for the propeller of the, let's say, the C-130. I'm not sure exactly what the speed of the propeller is, but it's probably between 2,200 and 2,800 RPM. So what's that? 14,000 to 2,500 is, what's that, 6-to-1 reduction, something like that. Anyway, the reduction gearbox is not part of the industrial engine. The output shaft is 13,800 RPM, and it comes right out of there. Now, the T56 or 501 is a bit of a different engine than what I'm used to, because it doesn't have a power turbine. The mechanical drive is directly connected to the compressor and turbine rotor. So there's only one shaft or one spool, and I'll demonstrate that right now. We're gonna turn this thing over, because it does turn. You gotta be careful not to get your fingers caught. Okay, this is the way the engine turns. You can see the 14 stages of compression are all turning all the way along there. And the gas has come through the diffuser into the combustion chambers. We'll look at those in a second. But if you take a look at all four stages of the turbine, they are turning with the compressor. There's only one shaft in this engine. Okay, let's take a front-to-back tour. Okay, this is the air intake of the T56 501 Allison, now Rolls-Royce. This would be a pitot inlet. I'll let to instrumentation there. Let you know the ram air speed, the ram air pressure, I guess, of the intake. Out here is where the main drive shaft drives the reduction gearbox or mechanical load. Right there, right down there, is where the radial drive shaft goes to come out on this pad. And on that pad is normally a accessory drive gearbox, which drives the oil pump, fuel pump, that sort of thing. Okay, that's the front frame. Now we've got the compressor rotor. And you can see that the first thing in there, let's look from the other side, is a set of inlet guide vanes. And you can see that they don't move. You see that they don't move? First we have the struts of the front frame. Then we have, let me reach around there, reach in there, that thing. that thing is a variable, no, it's not a variable, it's an inlet guide vane. It doesn't move, doesn't change angle. And then the first thing that's moving is the stage one compressor blades. So we have inlet guide vane there, stage one compressor blade, and then of course stage one stator. That this first one has been cut down because that's just what happened when the thing got sliced up to become a part of our cutaway. Stage two compressor blade, stage two stator, and all down the line. There's a little bit of staining here from running, that's a bit of soot. You've got different shapes of compressor stages, just the way they're aerodynamically designed, and you can see the narrowing path of the gases. This is the 14th stage compressor rotor blades, and then there would be, you can call those the 14th stage compressor stators, right there, and then right there, those are the outlet guide vanes, and they tend to straighten the airflow, make it more straight back, and remove the rotational component of their velocity. Okay, then we go into the diffuser, or the midframe. This is where the main thrust bearing is. The main thrust bearing is inside there, and the air comes through that passageway. I've got a light here. There's the outlet guide vanes. The air comes out of that divergent pathway, and some of it, a small amount of it, enters the combustion chamber, the combustor liner. And you can see there's little passageways here, and there's little holes there to allow some of that air to go inside, and that air feeds the flame. It mixes with the fuel, and the flame is in this area right here. And all these slots and holes in the combustor liner allow mixing air to come from this passageway in to mix with the flame, diluting the flame, reducing its temperature, and while it's reducing the temperature of the flame, the cooling air heats up, so that by about here you have a uniform and larger volume, uniform temperature, larger volume of air. It gets accelerated through this nozzle. Let's get that light again. Through that nozzle into the first stage of the turbine. Okay, and then you've got another stage of nozzle, second stage nozzle, second stage turbine. These first two stages are shrouded, which means right here there's a knife edge seal on the edge of the blades that protrudes into an abradable seal material, and that prevents leakage around the tips, which would represent wasted power. The third and fourth stage of the turbine are not shrouded because they're heavier and longer, and the shrouding becomes less and less advantageous as the weight, or as the pressure of the air reduces. So let's see, we've got the third stage turbine there, and the fourth stage turbine, and their two sets of nozzles are right there. Okay, that little projection right here, that's the remnants of one of the vanes of the turbine nozzle. It's just that way because that's the way the engine cases were sliced up. And then this is the exhaust cone, and there's the rear bearing, and there's the, let's see if I can turn this and we'll get a bit of a view of the, there we go. All right, and then the tangentially arranged struts on the exhaust cone, that's just for strength and positive location of the bearing in this turbine rear frame. Okay, you may have noticed that this fuel nozzle, there would be a combustor liner right here. This fuel nozzle looks different than that one. What this one is, this is a regular jet fuel, liquid fuel nozzle. Air comes in through there and mixes with the jet of fuel coming out of the tiny hole in the center is for starting, and the ring around the tiny cone is secondary fuel flow or main fuel flow. And you can see the swirler vanes around, which help to swirl the air and make for a better burning pattern. Now this one's removable. This is a gaseous fuel nozzle. And this is used for natural gas or propane. Would be used in an industrial engine, not in an aircraft, because aircraft use liquid fuel. So, fits right there. This is also a good opportunity to show the importance of the cooling air jacket around the combustor liner. This case here, gets to 400 or 500 degrees max when it's running. Right here, right in this area, you've got 3,000 degree plus air and flame mixture. And by the time it gets here, it's a little less than 900 degrees Celsius, which is safe for these guys. You don't want to melt them. So we've got a section of, I believe this is the first stage turbine nozzle. And I was talking about mixing cooling air with burning air. If you run your engine too hot, you get this kind of damage. It's basically burnt away, and pieces of that will soon be flying out the back of the engine. But before they go out the back, they hit the second, third, and fourth stages of the turbine. It's the beginning of a real disaster, and you can see the distortion here from melting and flowing under pressure. Look at the damage in that turbine nozzle because of overheating and a little bit of impact as well. That's why this engine's become a cutaway versus being repaired. Okay, and typical of the way a lot of engines are built, you've got the midframe here with the center main bearing. It's a very strong assembly, and then you've got what this is called the inner combustor case, because in this tube is the main shaft of the whole engine. But this tube is very strong, it's structural. It bolts between the midframe and the turbine cases. And it's a very strong, solid pillar of steel. It provides at least half the strength of the engine, if not more. And then the other part of the strength is this case, the outer combustor case, being bolted to the turbine case. So between the outer combustor case and the inner combustor case is the gas path, and in the gas path is the combustor liner. Sometimes called the can. This is the gas path. It's a beautiful illustration of the shape of the gas path here. And the one thing we don't have in this cutaway, or one of the things we don't have in the cutaway, is if there was going to be a combustor liner here, you can see there's the hole to the next one. These things are joined. This is the interconnector. It allows flame to travel between the two. This one's been cut off. And there's the other one. The whole ring of six is interconnected, which is why there's only two of them with igniter plugs. And the combustor inner liner that happens to be cut open is an igniter liner. There's the igniter plug. It's very similar to a surface gap spark plug, but in aviation, they're called igniter plugs, just to be different. This engine weighs around 1,200 pounds. Now that does not include the reduction gearbox. It's just the basic power production unit. So its output power is 4,000 horsepower-ish, about 4,000 horsepower at 13,800 RPM. What you do with that through reduction and all that is the responsibility of the customer, how they want to arrange their system. But when this engine is used in natural gas compression, it runs a centrifugal compressor in a pipeline, which moves gas down the pipeline. And at 4,000 horsepower, the engine this replaces, the engine that replaces, a piston engine, is literally the size of this entire shop bay, up to the Canadian flag. And the snowmobile. Okay, so various models of the T56 go from 2,700 horsepower to 4,700 horsepower. And the difference in power is the later models have higher temperatures, more efficient compressors, and more efficient turbines. Okay, I mentioned that the compressor doesn't have variable stators. So how does it control compressor stall at the transitional speeds? The 501 has a very efficient compressor, so it's got bleed valves. And they close progressively as the engine increases in RPM until it reaches what would be called flight idle, at which time they're all closed and all the air coming through this is being fed into the combustion section. So you can use variable stators or bleed valves, and the Rolls-Royce 501, originally the Allison 501, uses bleed valves. And what's this thing? Looks like a little periscope, doesn't it? What that is, this is more of an industrial piece of equipment. This is a vibration transducer, and it's mounted on a little pedestal which tends to slightly magnify the effects of vibration. It's used for monitoring engine condition. And right here, these are the holes, the pads, on which mount thermocouples. So the thermocouples in the 501, they measure turbine inlet temperature, which is much hotter than turbine outlet temperature, which is what the 1500 measures. So what that means is you get a much more realistic reading that you don't have to calculate upwards of the temperature of the gases reaching the turbine. So you know with more certainty exactly how hot the turbine is, and you can run it closer to the edge, I guess. The only disadvantage is the thermocouples in the 501, they run very hot and they don't last very long. Burning out the thermocouples is one of the maintenance things that's pretty intensive on a 501 because of the position and the design of the engine, the position of the thermocouples. They're right here. Look at that. The thermocouple goes right into the gas path. Right ahead of the hottest stationary component, which is the first stage nozzle. So there were about 18,000 plus of these engines made, and they're still being manufactured. So there's lots of them out there. Burns about 2,400 pounds an hour of jet fuel, consumes 32.5 pounds per second of air, and now that you've been from one end to the other of a 501 or a T56, minus the reduction gearbox and the propeller, you're a turboprop expert. Look at that beauty. Once again, thanks for watching.